can I do for you, children?
When's your birthday?
Birthday?
On Christmas. Oh. Oh, we'd like to know for sure. It's on your birthday.
Oh, yes.
On Christmas. We'll be waiting round your door. Have a party.
A party?
On your birthday.
That's woken me up.
Isn't that what friends are for?
Well, I suppose it is.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
On Christmas.
Thank you very much.
Happy ever more.
Cake and candles.
On your birthday. And we'll all be there to shout. What's that? For your whiskers.
Father
Christmas. As you blow those candles out. Got a present.
A present.
For your birthday.
A secret
that we'll never, ever, ever, ever tell. What's the answer, Father Christmas?
What do you want to know?
When's your birthday?
My birthday?
Yes!
Oh, I haven't had a birthday since I can't remember when.
Can't you remember?
I used to have from every year, or was it every 10?
Can't you remember?
Well, look, does it really matter? Shall we make today the day? What do you say, kids?
Yeah!
Yeah!
Great to have you here, my friends, and great to hear you say
Happy birthday!
A happy birthday!
Father Christmas!
To Father Christmas!
And we're all right here for sure!
Because why?
It's your birthday!
Right!
Father Christmas!
We just decided!
And we're waiting round your door! Have a party!
We're having a party!
On your birthday!
It's on your birthday!
Isn't that what friends are for?
Can I take this off? Oh, can I take all this stuff off? It's so hot. Oh, hang on to that sausage. Where's my real glasses? Hang on to those for me. Don't eat them all at once. That's me. That's better. We can all take a seat. Except for this lot. Here we are to wish you a seasonal greetings from Salisbury and to the sound of the jingling school bells of the boys and girls of... Right, we've come here to Westwood St. Thomas, and we're going to spend part of our Christmas holidays... thought that was good. ...with carols, Christmas songs, a few old chestnuts, plus a few Christmas facts. Oh, what was that? Oh, Stephen. Where's Stephen Wilcox? Stand up, Stephen. It's your birthday today, I gather, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Happy birthday, Stephen!
That's good, isn't it? Take a seat, old son. And what's this for me?
Yeah.
I better have a quick look in here. Roll Fat Christmas and... Oh! That's interesting. There's some fascinating facts here about the wonderful Christmas pig.
You've heard of the wonderful Christmas goose and the walloping great meat pie. But I think myself it's not much use to tell you a monstrous lie. I'll tell you what the marvel now, as sure as I'm a sinner, about a wonderful great meat pig they had for Christmas dinner. That great, incredible, wonderful, incredible, marvelous Christmas pig. The very first day the pig was born, he cut a few rummy capers. He swallowed up two big fields of corn and 42 ton of taters. They took and drew out all his teeth, but that just made him snarly. So he swallowed a wagon load of Swedes and a wagon load of barley. That great, incredible, wonderful, edible, marvelous Christmas pig. This wonderful pig, he grew so fat, he overflowed Hyde Park. His head, they say, when 3 days old, was big as Noah's Ark. His head was like a greasy pole with a tongue that bristles on it. And his curly tail, when pulled out straight, was the shape of a lady's bonnet. That great, incredible, wonderful, edible, marvelous Christmas pig. His ear was big as Temple Bar, or so the people tell us. And every time he heaved a sigh, was like a blacksmith's bellows. His back was like Blackfriars Bridge, and if I'm not mistaken, his head and neck was made of pork, and his latter end was bacon. That great, incredible, wonderful, edible, marvelous Christmas pig. to kill that marvellous Christmas pig. They all got tired of trying, for I won't tell you a word of a lie, he was 17 years and dying. And when at last they laid him out, this pig that was so frisky, in Charing Cross they placed his snout and his tail in the Bay of Biscay. That pretty critical buttery and all Christmas pig. Butchers, please, send to the front, that's it. 200 butchers went to work with cleavers, knives and choppers, and it took them nigh on 7 years to cut off one of his trotters. One knuckle bone they had for lunch, and in Hyde Park they took it, and they had to boil the serpentine in a vain attempt to cook it. That British middle of one of the edible mother Christmas pig. His bones were sent to flour mills to be ground up for flour. That's logical, fill 300,000 sacks in less than half an hour. The queue began on Christmas Eve, and as far as I remember, they were still there serving meals from him the following September. That great incredible one of the edible mother Christmas pig. And again, great incredible one of the edible mother of the wonderful Christmas
masks off so we can see your faces, and now give yourselves a clap for some brilliant artwork on those masks. You made them all themselves, isn't that good? Fantastic, fantastic. Nice job. Something I would like you to see, something of great interest. Come across here with me. Could you hold that for me, love?
Because I can use this little microphone now, see?
In the story of Christ's birth, you remember that the three wise men brought presents, gold, frankincense and myrrh. Now, we all know what gold is, but I didn't know anything about frankincense or myrrh. Did you know anything about them? No. So we did a little bit of research, and we've got a piece of gold here. Well, it's not real gold, otherwise we'd be worth a fortune, and I wouldn't be able to lift it. But that shows you what a block of gold looks like, and this is frankincense. Let me explain what frankincense was, or what it still is. It was taken from the bark of the frankincense tree, cut out these little tiny bits, and it was used a lot in healing. It also, when you burn it, it creates that lovely pungent smell that they used to use in temples. It's called incense. Okay, so that's frankincense. Very, very expensive in the old days. They don't use it at all now for medicines, but very expensive. Terrifically important gift. This is myrrh, which came from a little tiny sort of bushy tree with little sort of spikes on it, and they would cut the bark and this would ooze out, little droplets of this. I guess it's the sap or something, like gluey stuff would come out. And then it would slowly harden and turn into these reddish-coloured, browny-coloured things. And that was used a lot by the Israelites to make perfume. And it was also used in embalming dead people when they were dead. They used to use this to embalm the bodies. So that was also incredibly expensive. So when they brought the presents of gold, which was... Gold has been discovered, I don't know, something like 2,500 years before the birth of Christ, and it always signified kingship. If you gave a gold present, it was because the person was a king. And frankincense signified divinity, and myrrh signified healing powers. So you see, there were three wonderful gifts to give to the baby Jesus. There was one person, unfortunately, who didn't have a gift of any sort, the little drummer boy. I want you to have a look at the beautiful drawings that these youngsters and all the other kids in Wilton Middle School have done for this song. Just look at this.
Come, they told me, ta-ra-pum-pum. Our newborn king to see, ta-ra-pum-pum. Our finest gifts we bring, ta-ra-pa-pum-pum, to lay before our king, ta-ra-pa-pum-pum, ra-pa-pum-pum, ra-pa-pum-pum. So to honour him, ta-ra-pa-pum-pum, when we come.
None fit to give our king, ta-ra-pa-pum-pum. I played my drum for him, ta-ra-pa-pum-pum. I played my bass for him, ta-ra-pa-pum-pum, ta-ra-pa-pum-pum.
I suppose they picked me to be their coachman because I'm such a handsome fellow. But actually, I'm here to whip up some applause for Jake the Peg.
I'm Jake the Peg, dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-da, with my extra leg, dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-da, wherever I go. I had a dreadful childhood, really. Well, I suppose I shouldn't moan. Each time they had a three-legged race, I won it on me own. And also I got popular when came the time for cricket. They used to roll my trousers up and use me for the wickets.
I'm Jake the Peg.
I was a dreadful scholar. I found all the lessons hard. Well, the only thing I knew for sure was 3 feet make a yard. To count to 10, I used me fingers, and if I needed more, by taking my shoes and socks off, I could count to 24.
Stop the minute. What? I better just check. He said 21, you say 25. I'll just check. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that's right. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, that's right. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 22, 23, 24, 25.
225.
I'm Jake the Peg.
With my itchy leg. Whatever I did, they said was false. They said, quick march, I did a quick waltz. And then they shouted at me,
put your best foot forward.
But which foot? I said, it's very fine for you. You've only got a choice of two. But me, I'm
Jake the Peg. Diddle-diddle-diddle-diddle.
With my extra leg.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
That's very nice. You heard of the Holly and the Ivy, haven't you?
The Holly and the Ivy.
Remember that song? Yeah. Well, Holly, in the old days, Holly was supposed to be the universal cure. The Holly was supposed to cure measles, gout, dropsy, lumbago, itchy nose, itchy scalp, bad ears, kneecaps. The only thing it wouldn't cure is the Holly itself. I sat on a bit just a minute ago. I soon got the point. Listen, let's all go down to Longleat and we'll deck the halls with boughs of holly. Good idea?
bring us out to table and spread it with the cloth. Bring us out to pony cheese and some of your Christmas loaf. Love and joy come to you, and to you your words will do. And God bless you and send you a happy new year. And say,
good. That was good fun. That was absolutely tremendous fun, actually, filming there at Longleat. And I'd like to thank the Marquess of Bath for letting us all go in there. Wasn't it good, those who were there doing that filming? Wasn't that great fun? To be in the Victorian kitchens and to go up the grand staircase and up into the upper rooms. Just beautiful. And the Marquess of Bath himself came and watched most of the filming, and it was really nice to meet him. Thank you very much. Shall we do a picture?
Yes!
Yeah. Let's do it. Let's do it. Now, I'm going to start by sloshing a bit across there, roughly like that. Ding-a-ding-a-ding. Hope that's right. Probably a bit too high, but means I'll probably have to make the rest of the picture a bit higher. A little bit in there. A bit through there. And if we do a little fiddly bit in there like that, just to let me know where I am. And then there's a bit that comes across there, and another bit that comes across there. That can go there, there. And the darkest bit in there. Well, courage and confidence, that is. Now, I'll put a bit of a dark brown bit in there. Are you enjoying it so far? Boom, 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 boom. A bit wider there like that. And a bit there, a bit there. There, like that. Yes. Can I give you that? And I'll take that one from you. Have you got a brush for me? Did I give you a brush? Oh, I thought you'd lost the brush. Are you interested in Christmas facts at all?
Yeah.
Yeah. Any idea when the first Christmas card was made? The only reason I've got any idea is I looked it up. The first Christmas card, the very first one, was made in 1853, I think it was, or 43, 18. Somewhere around there, about 130-odd years ago. Yeah, 1853. And the man who made it was a fella called Henry Coles. Well, and he had a lot of bright ideas. And this idea was to have a card which was specially for Christmas. He actually also invented the postcard. And he was the man who invented the idea of putting little perforations in stamps so that when you rip them off, they'll actually rip along the line. I always thought that was Roy Hudd. Put the little perforations in. Oh, well, don't worry about it. Now then, if I put a little piece in there like that, a little bit down there, a little bit there. Where's that brown again? Who's got the brown? Thanks, Jonathan. Swap you for that. For that. Little piece goes in there. And I think I'll put a little bit down there like that. And perhaps a bit of brownness in there. And a big bit there like that. And a bit. Bit up there and a little bit down under there. Now, what I'd like is that very pale one. Thank you, Lisa. Can I swap you that for that? Don't get any paint on yourself. Was I talking about the fellow that invented Christmas cards? Yeah, he got an artist to actually design the first card, and then he had it printed by a firm in Holborn. And he sold something like 1,000 of them. He had a man specially there to paint all the colour in. What do you think that is I've just painted? Hey? Little baby, yeah. Hope it looks like a baby. I'll need that pink colour back, Jonathan, again. I'll put some other colours in around him, and I'll perhaps put a little place where his eye fits in there like that. Like that. And I'll put a little bit of pink in under his, where his nose is going to be, and a little bit of pink shadow there. And this sort of Christmas card that I'm trying to paint now for you is modelled on a beautiful painting by a man called Georges de la Tour. Now, what colour shall I pinch now? I'll try a bit of black, I think, my love. Thank you. And we'll put some nice shadow there. Can you see the shape of the face appearing here? And it's a mother looking down at the little child. There's an eyebrow up there, another eyebrow. And I think I'll just try that red, Joanna. Just hold the bucket there and I'll put some... Okay. Oh, I'll use that for the baby's mouth. Just have his little mouth in there like that, just curled up, his little bottom lip all curled up. A little bit of shadow under his nose there. Perhaps a little bit where the eye would go. Does that look like a babe? Put a bit of darkness down the side of the mother's face here. A little bit of dark in there. And now we'll try and put some really dark stuff around the top of her head like that. Mm-hmm. Just to outline the shape of her face coming down to the edge of the dress there. Mm-hmm. Oh. Darkness around there, and you can see some of the material and things. She's got her hair tied with a scarf, and it's all a dark browny scarf there, and we make that really nice and dark, so it's a looks like a candle lit picture there. I think I need some really bright white. Who's got it? Yeah, what was your name? Peter. Thanks, Peter. And we'll put the baby's swaddling clothes in there like that, just around the top of his little bald head. Pity to be bald so young, isn't it? And we'll put a nice little bit of light reflected off his little shiny head there. A little bit of light just by his eye. A little bit around his nose there. A little bit on his cheek. Hey, that looks good, doesn't it? Yes, he looks all sort of moist and newly dried and lovely. And a little bit, perhaps a little bit of light on the edge of the dress there, on that sheer material. Is that all right? Give us a nice little clap for that. Thanks, Peter. You can go and sit down now. Thanks very much. Have a seat, love. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks. You can have a seat, Joe. There's a lovely chair there for you. I did some research in the British Museum years and years ago and found a lovely old song called Mary of the Quiet Eyes, which I'd like to sing for you now. And I want you particularly to listen to Barry Booth's lovely arrangement of this music. Listen.
Watches the beloved, lovely little one. See her bending over the manger where he lies, with such shining wonder in her quiet eyes. See her stoop to kiss him while he is asleep. She will lift him gently and weep. Hear her singing softly little lullabies with a tender glory. Thank you. and sleep. She will lift him gently should he wake and weep. Hear her singing softly little lullabies with such shining wonder in her quiet eyes.
Lovely song. I just love that song. I think it's a particularly lovely song. And I don't think many people have ever heard it. Have you ever heard that song before?
No.
Such a lovely one. Of course, there are hundreds and hundreds of songs which give the Christmas message, which we almost don't seem to ever have to have learnt. Songs that we seem to have known ever since we were that big. They are, of course, the carols. Shall we do a few carols? Let's go a-caroling. Yeah?
Yeah!
Let's do it.
On a cold winter's
was just delightful. Give yourselves a big clap, and everybody who sang, a big clap. Well, those traditional carols, I don't know how they made you feel. I hope they made you feel as good as they made us feel. It was lovely, wasn't it? Lovely, warm feeling. Just about brings our Salisbury Christmas box to a close. Just with one little bit, some lovely artwork from all these youngsters here from Wilton Middle School to finish the show. And one last thing, you ready for everybody listening? One, two, three.
Merry Christmas, everybody!